five general rules of thumb for people who are serious about preparing for these WGI indoor and DCI summer auditions. I want to share this information out for other people who might be in the same boat. What's up, replay viewers? Huey here. Good to see everyone. Happy Friday. I hope everyone's been having a great week so far. Before we get started, let me just say hi to a couple folks. Hi, Diddle Dudes. Welcome to the room. Thank you so much. Matthew. Hi, Smiley Snare. Kalima. Victoria. Welcome. Colin. Oh, hey, guys. Gridbook Series. Thanks for coming in, and thank you for those hearts. We can see that coming through. If you're watching this after the fact on Instagram, you want to share this out, this video is available on Facebook. So if you go to my Facebook page, facebook.com/HueyYuanPan, you can watch this replay, and you can also leave additional questions on there. And if you find this valuable, feel free to share this out with your friends or tag your friends as well. This question is coming from Sam, and he says, I'm auditioning in November 18th, and I have a friend from my high school going with me. What kind of practice regimen would you recommend we follow between now and then to clean ourselves up and prepare? Now, this is an interesting question because between now, it's September's almost over. We've got October and then November. You've got maybe like a month and a half until you start attending these auditions. Maybe you're auditioning for a WGI group. You've gone to a couple chop sessions and the auditions are coming up in a couple weeks, right? Basically, everything you do between now and the actual audition is gonna determine whether or not you're successful or unsuccessful when you go to the audition. Well, part of it is also the execution and, you know, the luck factor and who else shows up. But I would say 90% of the work is what you do before you actually go to the audition. This is the most crucial period. And what I told Sam is that the practice regimen is going to change depending on your skill sets, where you're at with it, your previous experience, things like that. What I can offer are five general rules of thumb for people who are serious about their auditions. These are the folks who are gunning to make a spot. They're probably the more veteran players. They've been more self-aware of what they do to be more successful later on down the road. Put 10 minutes on the clock here and let's just talk through the five. So the first thing I mentioned to Sam was practice every day. You know, each day that you're not moving forward, you're actually moving backwards. There's no such thing as just stagnating, right? Think of it as that you're on one of those walking escalators at the airport. If you stop practicing, the escalator will actually move you back. You get a little rusty, right? And then when you do practice the following day or 2 days later, you're spending time just catching back up to where you left off. So this is so important that if you are serious about practicing, it doesn't have to be for 2, 3, 5 hours a day. Even if it's for 20 minutes on a day that you're super busy, pick those sticks up, pick those mallets up. You gotta get the instrument on your face or in your hands so that you are at least maintaining. At the very least, you wanna maintain what you've got done and not move backwards. So this takes us to point number two, which is if you are serious about practicing every day, you need to schedule your practice time. A lot of times students say, oh, well, wait, I don't have time, right? Well, show me your calendar and I'll show you your priorities, right? Where you're spending your time is where your priorities are. So if you are really serious about auditioning, you're saying like, I really wanna make this group, then you've got to look at your calendar and schedule out the time to make that happen. So I'll give you an example. With all my private students, we schedule our practice times during the week. So we sit down together, and the way we do this is we have a grid for the 7 days and 1 hour blocks or 30 minute blocks, right? And we start by scheduling the essential items. When are you going to school? When are you eating? When are you doing your homework? When do you have your family time? You know, whatever your priorities are, the things that have to be there. Okay, from there, you start finding these 30-minute, 60-minute, 90-minute, 120-minute blocks of time where you can practice. And there are going to be days where maybe you're in class for the entire day, even if you wake up at 6 a.m. and then you're working, and then you go to class, and then you do your homework. Maybe you can only squeeze in 20 minutes of practice. Well, 20 minutes of practice is better than no practice, but you have to be very organized, especially the busier you are. People love to say how busy they are. The busier you are, the more diligent and the more proactive you have to be about scheduling your time. So tip number two, you gotta schedule your practice. Number three, video record yourself. We are in the best age of technology that we could possibly ask for. It's never been easier to record yourself and then to watch the video. Everyone knows this, everyone says this, that one of the best pieces of feedback that you can get is to video record yourself and watch the video. Very few of us actually do this enough. If you've ever watched like a American Idol or The Voice, any sort of competition, the people who are the most self-aware are the ones that when they walk out of the room, they say, oh, how'd you do? And you say, oh, it was okay. I thought I did pretty well, right? But the people who are usually the least self-aware are the ones that go in there and, you know, they don't sing very well. It's out of tune. They don't know the words. It's just not good. And you can see the judges cringing, right? And they walk out and they go, "How'd you do?" And you go, "Oh, it was amazing. I definitely made it." I always think, you know, did they ever just, you know, record themselves before they went in? If they recorded themselves and they listened back, you know, maybe they go like, "Oh, I got some stuff I need to work on," right? And what I would say, if you're auditioning, every audition includes a individual audition at some point. You're gonna walk into a room, there's gonna be a set of drums, or there's gonna be a marimba, and there's gonna be a person sitting across from you at the table, and they're gonna call out stuff for you to play, right? So at some point, you are gonna be by yourself where you have no external factors affecting you. You're not having to listen or adjust to other people. You just have to execute your part as an individual. And the question that I ask my students is, would you give yourself a call back? If you watched your own video, would you be like, "Yep, that person, definitely we need to give that person a callback." And there's like different layers of this too. Either you're like, "Okay, I'm interested in seeing this person again." And then there's the kind of student that walks in when they audition, you're like, "Whoa, we gotta lock this guy down before they audition somewhere else, because maybe they're auditioning with this other group, but we gotta lock them down. Let's offer them a contract right away." What you can do is video record yourself and put yourself in the shoes of the tech who might be auditioning you, and ask yourself, if I watched this video, would I give myself a callback? Would I give myself a contract? If the answer is no, then you got some work to do, right? If you have questions, guys, the best place to send these questions is gonna be on my Facebook page. I'm like shocked at the number of Instagram folks who are just living on Instagram, which is great. You know, Instagram stories is where I do a lot of this behind the scenes stuff. But there's a ton of content on my Facebook page. Again, facebook.com/WayyoungPan. If you wanna get in there, you can dig around in the video archives, you can leave me messages. And the thing that I love about that is you can leave me questions on videos, and then I can reply back to you. But then it's, you know, it's available for everybody. So we're just sharing the information. Let's keep moving, guys. We've got just a few more minutes here. Number four, practice as if you're at the audition. This is very important because a lot of times students don't realize the difference between practice mode and performance mode, right? When you're in practice mode, a lot of times you see people who are playing and they're looking down at their hands, or they're checking themselves out in the mirror. And that's part of it. You're self-evaluating. But you forget that when you are in performance mode, you've got to play as if you're standing in the lot or you're on the field at finals. The biggest difference is when you're practicing, you are analyzing what's happening as you're playing, right? You're thinking, "Okay, well, I need to do this. I'm slow, I'm fast." When you're in performance mode, you are just 100% focused on executing. You've got to turn off that voice in your head, you know, self one, self two. You've got to turn that voice off in your head. And a lot of young players, they struggle with this when they get into, you know, the pressure cooker, the audition room, or you're making it down to the final 10 or final 15, right? You start overanalyzing things and you're talking to yourself. I actually struggled with this a lot when I was younger. When I first started out, there's like too many things to pay attention to. And I had trouble turning off all the voices and just focusing on my one job, and then you see people who are breaking as a result of that because your brain is getting overloaded. I talked about this in the intro to one of my buddies, Dre, who's my inside snare in the years that I marched at Cavs. And what we would do is before every run, we would look at each other and say, "This is finals." Every time we did a run, when we were on a cornfield in the middle of nowhere, even though we were doing a run, we would do it as if this was finals night, come August, you know, mid-August at the end of the year. So if you're at home, then let's say you have an hour to practice and you spend 45 minutes practicing, targeting something that you're trying to make better through repetition and making it more consistent, and you're elevating the level that you're able to execute it. The last 15 minutes, you need to set some time aside and say, "Okay, for the next 15 minutes, I'm gonna practice performing. So I'm gonna do my individual audition for the next 10 minutes. Or I'm gonna run through all the exercises in the book, but I'm not gonna stop when I make a mistake. I'm not going to self-correct. I'm not gonna look down. I'm not gonna do all those things that you do when you're practicing by yourself, but you're gonna practice as if you are performing in the line at the auditions." A lot of times you hear people say, "You perform the way you practice," and one adjustment I would add to that is practice the way you want to perform. So if you want to perform a certain way, you have to be doing that at home by yourself in a room when no one else is watching if you want to show up later. Last thing, practice with a buddy. There's so many things I want to say and write about this, but I'm going to have to give you the Cliff Notes version. A lot of the things that I was able to accomplish when I was auditioning, and for sure now, a lot of things that I'm able to accomplish while I'm teaching or creating content for you guys, is as a result of having a partner or someone to hold me accountable. When I was auditioning for Phantom and for Cavaliers. My roommate and I, we were going to college together. We lived together. We played in the college marching band together. And we went to all these auditions together. And so what that did is you just had someone that was always working. You know, if the guy next to you is working, you're going to be less apt to be a bum and sit there and binge watch Netflix. But there's a practical thing that you should also be doing with your buddy. If you've got someone that's going to the audition with you, many of you who are auditioning, maybe you're the top dog at your school. You're used to being the center snare. And being a great center snare versus being a great wingman are two very different skill sets. When you're the center snare, you are listening to the metronome, executing your part perfectly so that everyone can just match you. You want to be the archetype member. You're listening to specific sections. Maybe you're listening forward or you're listening back. You're coordinating between different lines. You have different responsibilities. You're just worried about yourself and then lining up your part to whatever you should be listening to at that moment in the show. When you're a wingman, it doesn't matter what you think is necessarily right or wrong. Your job is to listen or watch, if you're in the front ensemble, and match the person that you're assigned to as your listening responsibility. Just practicing by yourself, which I know many of you are, you're in a room and you're just shedding and working your hands. One of the most important things that you're missing out on practicing, and maybe this is one of, if not the most important thing when you go to an audition, is how well can you play with other players? You could have the best chops in the world, perfect hands, perfect technique, play crazy fast, crazy chops, stick tricks galore. But if you can't play with the people next to you, then it's not gonna work. What the staff is looking for are 8 snares or 9 snares or 10 snares that can play together. They have the same approach. They play well with the people next to them. They need people who can play together. And they need 4 or 5 tenors that can play together. They need 5 basses that gel, right? So as they're moving people in and out of the room or in the spots and out of the spots, they're trying to, you know, create a sound concept of people who are playing together. It's the same thing for the front ensemble, really for any section within an organization. If you've got a buddy, what you should do is take turns being the center snare. So in this rep, or maybe for the next 10 minutes, you're responsible for just being perfect, right? And then this person's job is to listen and match this person. And everyone has a little different, you know, idiosyncrasies. And as the wingman, your job is to be able to anticipate, read, adapt, and follow the person that is your inside listening responsibilities. Because this is what's going to happen. When you get to the audition, you're not always going to be standing next to someone that you know or you're familiar with. And how quickly you can adapt to the person next to you, maybe you need to play a little stronger. Maybe you need to lighten up a little bit. Maybe you need to play a little bit lower, a little bit higher. You have to be able to adjust in the moment. The more of a chameleon that you can be, the less freaked out you'll be when you're in the audition. There's like 20 more tips that I would love to give, but these are the 5 things that you should be practicing that you can prepare for as you're going to these auditions. Let me just wrap up with this, guys. If you found this helpful, please let me know. Send me a direct message, send me an email, go to my contact page on my website, hoyumpan.com. Let me know. I've got this feeling that there are a lot of people out there who are working on these things, and what I've come to realize is that the DCI, WGI audition process, unless you've been to one or you've been doing it a long time, there are just a lot of things. I mean, I think back to before I auditioned, I didn't know anything, right? So if you have questions and you want to answer these questions before you go to the audition, let me know. Send me a message, okay? If you have more questions, the best place to do this is to find this video and leave me a question, because then what I can do is I can answer that question publicly after the fact on that page. Handle for all my social media at @HoiYuanPan, and just let me know how you guys are doing. The question of the day is, what is the biggest question that you have about auditions as you're coming up? Maybe you're a teacher and you have a question about how to prepare your students. I've prepared tons of students that I showed them how to hold the stick, and 6 years later, they're the center snare at a top 12 drum corps, or they're playing marimba at a top 12 drum corps or top 12 DCI line. So it's teachers, students, let me know how I can help. And I'll do my best to do so. All right, guys, thanks for watching the video. Hope you're doing great, and I'll see you guys next time. All right, bye, guys. Thanks.